Hey y'all, you know what time it is. Okay, that was a terrible fail. I'm so sorry. Alright, take two. Action. No, I'm just kidding. Hold on. There we go. Woo! Get into it! Get into it! Yes! I feel like I'm really far away. Let's get a little closer. Too close. A little too close. There. No, I'm just kidding. Hi y'all. I'm on the couch tonight. I feel like the one of my favorite kids' TV shows, Big Comfy Couch, if anybody remembers that. I feel like that hostess, I cannot remember her name right now off the top of my head, but that is the vibe that I'm getting. Matt Gutierrez! Hi! I miss your face. We need to talk. We need to catch up. Yes, for those fans that are of fans of this anime, yes, I am wearing an Attack on Titan shirt. No, I am not a fan of the anime. The manga? Sure. Not the anime. And in my strong opinion, Attack on Titan is not one of the best animes of all time. I said what I said. I said what I said. There are tons of others that definitely deserve that title. I said what I said. And if you want to fight me about that, message me privately and with all respect, respectfully. Just because I don't like it, though, doesn't mean that it's not good. I just think that it's very bold to suggest a show like this is the best of all time. The only reason why I have this shirt, one, it's comfortable, and two, it was cheap when I bought it because it was on sale, and three, Team Levi all day. Team Levi all day. No Aaron. No Team Aaron over here. Yes! Yes, Bleach! Maguchi, I wish I could show you right now, but I'm getting ready for story time. But I have the entire Bleach manga. I have volume 1 all the way to 74. And they're starting up a new chapter. So I'm definitely going to be collecting that. Hi, Uncle Paul! Much love and respect to you. I hope you enjoy your early birthday trip to Cali. Say hello to my big head. Cousin Paul, let him know what's up. Love y'all. Yeah, I'm just getting ready to read. We're back. I know it's been about a week since we've... it's been about a week since we've read Totoro. We only have 2 chapters left, so... we can get that done. We can get that done this week. But I hope everybody's having a good time, a shoe shine, and a full tank of gas. But... I just want you to sit back, relax, unwind. I'm gonna switch the music just a tad. I do not own the music that you may be listening to in the background. Gonna give something a little bit more mellow in tone. Oh yeah, this will be nice. Love you too, Uncle. Appreciate y'all. Like I said, you do not have to watch these videos when they go live. You're always welcome to watch them at your leisure on the YouTube channel, which is directly in my bio on Facebook as well as Instagram. All you gotta do is click it, like, share, subscribe. I always have to emphasize, I do not do this for profit, but because of YouTube's guidelines, I cannot go live on YouTube unless I have 1,000 subscribers. Once I get 1,000 subscribers, I could be able to go live on there at any time and immediately upload those videos to YouTube. But until then, I will have to download them from here and then upload them later, which hasn't been an issue these last few days because I had a technical issue, but I have since fixed it. So we are all good on that point. Matter of fact, yeah, I'm going to turn this way, which check out the poster. My favorite Spider-Man of all time, next to Scarlet Spider, of course, is Spider-Man Noir. And I was a fan before the Into the Spider-Verse movie came out, which that movie is amazing. Can't wait to watch Across the Spider-Verse Part 1, which is really interesting why they're splitting it up into parts. Shout out to Spider-Man fans who are out there. But without further ado, we will go ahead and read My Neighbor Totoro. Get my glasses. The library is open. Get my reading glasses. That's how I'm going to be when I'm 60, y'all. I'm going to be like, hold on, let me get my glasses on so I can see it. What is that? That's just going to be me at the age of 60. Chapter 8. Summer Vacation. Oh no! Kanta Ogaki squinted anxiously down the row from his vantage point in the garden, half hidden behind the compost pile. Tatsuo Kusakabe was coming toward him, flanked by his daughters. The girls were dressed from some kind of outing. It wasn't even 7 in the morning yet. Satsuki looked happy walking next to her father. Her short hair was fluffed out. She was wearing a white outfit with sailor collar trimmed in blue, a narrow-brimmed white hat and sandals. She was carrying a large wicker suitcase. Mei was wearing a yellow hat, a red and green checked dress, and a red leather shoes with white socks. She was carrying a green cloth backpack. Backpack looked stuffed. Just like a couple of city kids, Kanta thought as he watched them from behind the compost, mouth agape. He scurried into the house. Not now, he was panicking. Of all the times to come! It was Kanta's job to muck the stable in the morning. He had just been hauling yesterday's soiled straw to the compost pile in a wheelbarrow. It was smelly work, especially in summer. Very smelly. And now, Mr. Archaeologist and his daughters from the haunted house decided to turn up wearing their Sunday best. Kanta was so distracted that he almost knocked out his grandmother on her way to his room. He skidded to a stop in astonishment. Granny was dressed in a summer kimono and was putting on her sash. What's going on, Granny? Are you going out? Granny Ogaki wrapped the brown sash tight around her waist. Kanta almost never saw her dressed like this. She looked completely different. I'm off to Shikuoko Kuyama Hospital, Granny said. Why? Are you sick? Of course not. Satsuki and Mei are spending 10 days with their mother's relatives in Tokyo. They can't very well leave without paying their respects now, can they? I'm going along with them. Kanta snorted. How come their dad doesn't take him himself? He's very busy, Kanta. He has to be away from the house for a few days. Granny was just asking Kanta whether he wanted to go along when the sliding front door rattled open and a voice came from the entryway. Good morning. We're here. Kanta peeked out and saw Satsuki, Tatsuo, and Mei standing on the threshold. He ducked back inside, frozen with panic. Granny tucked her coin purse into her sash and took a cloth-wrapped parcel from the sideboard. Coming! Good morning! She called. Kanta heard Tatsuo say, We're so sorry to trouble you again. We really appreciate your help. He was being very polite. But he sounded as if he was in a hurry. Oh, excuse me, y'all. Sorry. Been up since 5:30. Oh, don't give it a second thought. I'm happy to be of help. It's not far. I've been waiting to meet your wife and give her my regards, Granny said. Kanta looked at the garden as he eavesdropped. It was going to be a beautiful day. He wondered what Satsuki's mother was like. Maybe it would be fun to meet her. He scowled. His mother had recently brought him a pair of trousers for special occasions, but the legs were so baggy they almost looked like a skirt. He decided he'd rather shovel manure than dress up like that. Depending on the pants, well, they're not knickerbockers, so it would be that style, because this is like 90s Japan, so. It's probably hakama pants. Not parachute pants. Now, I hope you two don't mind taking the train by yourselves, Tatsuo was saying to Satsuki.
Don't worry, we'll be fine.
She answered. But Kanta thought she sounded anything but confident. Give me a call in 10 days and let me know what time you want me to come get you, Tatsuo said. Aunt Kyoko is the number where I'll be staying. If you need to talk to me, just ask her. Mei, what are you doing? Come back here. Mei had taken an interest in Kanta's wheelbarrow just outside the door. She had grabbed the handles and was toddling off toward the compost pile, pushing it in front of her. Mei, I'm leaving. Come say goodbye. He turned to Satsuki. Your grandmother will be waiting for you at the platform when you get there. Be sure to get in the third car from the front so she can find you right away. I guess I told you that already, didn't I?
Daddy, call us once you're away, okay? Satsuki said. Even twice!
Will do. Granny, I'll leave them in your good hands then. I'd better be off. He said goodbye to Satsuki and Mei and looked and walked quickly down the path.
Well now, Granny said, we better be going ourselves. The bus will be along soon.
Kanta felt oddly disappointed after they left. He went to the living room and flopped listlessly on the tatami. His mother and brothers would be back from weeding the field soon. He was starving. Why didn't they hurry? life
was no fun.
When Granny saw Satsuki and Mei draped over their mother at the hospital, she smiled and said quietly, "Why, the two of you are just like babes in your mother's arms." Visitors were usually not allowed in the morning. Yasuko spoke quietly, too.
"Thank you for bringing them. I hope it wasn't too much trouble."
"Oh, that's all right. Satsuki and Mei are such good little girls. It's no trouble at all."
Yasuko quickly combed Satsuki's hair. She took two ribbons from the drawer next to her bed and decorated Mei's pigtails.
"Tell your grandmother not to worry. I'll be out of the hospital soon,"
Yasuko said. She seemed a bit nervous about the visit her daughters were about to make.
"Pick a place to put your train ticket and keep it there.
Mei, listen to what your sister tells you. Satsuki, I want you and Mei to be big girls and not expect to be too much help from Yone and Fume. They're very busy. And remember, don't talk back." Yasuko saw them to the door of the hospital.
"Take good care of yourselves, both of you. Be careful not to take the wrong train."
It brought tears of pity to Granny's eyes to see how Yasuko stroked Mei's cheek and hugged Satsuki as they said goodbye. It must break their mother's heart to have to be apart from these adorable little girls for so long.
"Don't worry about a thing, Mrs. Kusakabe. I'll see that they get on the train. Their grandmother will be waiting when they get there. Everything will be fine."
As they left the hospital, Satsuki was glad that they had gone to see their mother. Yasuko had told them she would probably be allowed to come home for 1 or 2 days during the summer vacation. Tetsuo would be home from his fieldwork on the day Satsuki and Mei came back from Tokyo. Satsuki was a little nervous about the prospect of 10 days with the Tenoshimas without their mother, but at least when she and Mei came back, the family would be together. The thought made her resolve to make the best of the 10 days in Tokyo.
"Put this in your backpack, Mei. It's from your mother," Granny said, and gave her a small box wrapped in paper. "Is it something to eat?" "Rice cakes. You can eat them in the train if you're careful not to make a mess."
Oh, there it is. I was looking for my water bottle.
I breezed through my tea before y'all got here.
When they arrived at the station, Granny bought their tickets. When Satsuki tried to pay, Granny shook her head and smiled.
"Don't worry about it, dear. When you get to Tokyo, buy yourself a nice magazine to read."
The train soon pulled into the station. It was empty. Just as planned, they went to the third car from the front. Satsuki waited by the door, but it didn't open. Granny opened it for her. Satsuki was surprised.
"Granny, isn't it supposed to open by itself? What happens if we get to Tokyo and I can't get it to open in time and the train leaves again?"
"Don't you worry. Once you get to the next station, the doors will open on their own."
They had never taken such a long ride on the train by themselves before, and Satsuki was feeling very tense. The departure bell started ringing. Satsuki and Mei got on the train.
"Thank you, Granny,"
Satsuki said. Granny said goodbye and closed the door. The train jolted forward. Granny smiled and waved. Soon she was out of sight. The girl sat down and looked silently out the window. It was 1 hour and 15 minutes to their destination. They began to relax a little as the train rolled along. They munched on rice cakes and timidly visited the next car, looking for a bin to throw away the wrappings. Gradually, the forest scenery disappeared, followed by the farmland as they got closer to Tokyo. Gray-tiled houses stood clustered together. Soon there was nothing but houses and buildings crowding the tracks on both sides. The dirty neon signs switched off for the day made Satsuki feel nostalgic. When the train arrived at their station and they stepped onto the platform, Yasuko's mother was waiting for them with Yuriko, their cousin. Yuriko was Satsuki's age.
"Grandma!"
Mei was overjoyed. She never left Satsuki's side on the train, but now she let go of her sister's hand and ran across the platform to Mrs. Tanoshima, her little legs pumping so hard that she nearly fell down. She threw her arms around her grandmother. Yasuko and Mei had parted when Mei was only 3 years old. Ever since, Mrs. Tanoshima had lavished affection on the lowly little girl. Mei loved her grandmother fiercely and basked in her affection. She was even more herself with Grandma than with Satsuki. Mrs. Tanoshima bundled everyone to a taxi and took them to a department store in Ginza. The 9th floor was full of restaurants.
The largest one had a display case with wax models of the dishes on the menu. As they stood outside the restaurant, Mrs. Terashima said,
"Let's have a nice lunch. What would you like?"
May's eyes widened when she saw the display case. She pressed her nose against the glass.
I want ice cream!
"That's dessert," Mrs. Terashima said. "What would you like for lunch, May?"
"I want, that one with the flag."
"The child plate? That's a good choice. What would you like, Satsuki?"
Satsuki didn't feel comfortable choosing a dish if her grandmother was going to treat. She finally said,
"I'll have what May's having."
"The child plate? Are you sure that's what you like?"
"Mm-hmm."
Yuriko tugged excitedly at her grandmother's sleeve.
"Can I have the broiled eel?"
"Certainly, Yuriko. Calm down. Satsuki, you don't dislike eel, do you?"
"No,"
Satsuki said. "Then the three of us can have the eel and make it at the child's plate. How does that sound?" After lunch, Mrs. Terashima took them to the 8th floor. The whole floor was devoted to toys. They were gaily flashing lights and wind-up toys playing musical instruments. May was almost beside herself with excitement. She pointed to the first doll she saw, cried,
"I want it!"
and tugged at her grandmother's hand. She saw a toy train.
"Please buy it!"
"Don't be so selfish, May," Satsuki scolded her. "It's not polite."
May puffed out her cheeks in frustration.
"But I want it!"
"It's all right, Satsuki," Mrs. Terashima said. "Today is a special day, and I haven't seen either of you for so long. If you like something, just tell me. It's my pleasure."
Satsuki nodded and said, "Thank you, Grandmother." She and her cousin walked over to a display of dolls. Excuse me. Satsuki had grown up with Yuriko, and they were close friends.
"Satsuki," said Yuriko, "do they have Bottle Baby where you live?"
Bottle Baby was a big fad. It was made from soft rubber and looked like a bit like a Q-Pie doll. It wore a diaper and could drink from a little bottle filled with water.
"Nope," Satsuki said as she gazed longingly at the dolls. "There's only one in Matsugo. You could get pen and pencils and miso and canned food. They sell vegetables, too. All kinds of everyday stuff. But they don't have much for kids."
Excuse me. Sorry, y'all.
"Maybe just fireworks." Yuriko looked astonished. "You really do live in the sticks."
"Yeah. Isn't it boring?"
Satsuki had never thought about it.
"No, it's not boring. Not really."
Mrs. Terashima urged Satsuki to choose something. But in the end, Satsuki couldn't bring herself to do it. She wasn't trying to be obstinate, but she felt sorry for Yuriko. It didn't feel right unless they both got something. If she'd been little like May, she would have been different. But Satsuki was in the 4th grade, and the thought of acting selfish embarrassed her.
"What about me?" Yuriko ventured several times. But Mrs. Terashima would just say, "Don't you already have all the toys you need?"
After the toy store, they went shopping for clothes. Mrs. Terashima showered them with new clothes, pants and skirts and chismes. I may have messed that up. Well, chisme is the Spanish term for gossip, if I'm not mistaken. For all my Spanish speakers, please correct me politely in the comments. Chisme is gossip, or like tea or te. Socks and blossoms and blouses and skirts. She bought them several pretty dresses. Everything was smart and chic. Chic. Say chic. Freak out! No, just kidding. When Satsuki said that they had bought plenty of clothing, Mrs. Terashima told her,
"Nonsense. I peeked in May's backpack. Everything looked rather wilted to me. Yasuko hasn't been able to look after you the way she would if she were healthy. It's not our fault, but I must say I was shocked."
There were so many purchases to take home that Mrs. Terashima had to hire an extra large taxi. She looked a little tired.
"This is a special day," she said.
When they arrived at the Terashima house, Satsuki and May ran excitedly into the entryway, shouting and laughing. It had been so long. "I'm home," they each called, as if they still lived there. They threw off their shoes, stepped up into the house, and slipped and slid down the polished wood of the hall to the foot of the stairs. Aunt Kyoko was just coming down. "No children on the 2nd floor," she said. "You'll be staying with Mother in the cottage." She went to the entryway and looked out. Mrs. Terashima was just paying for the taxi.
"What a lot of packages! Fumi!"
Aunt Kyoko called. "Come out here, please. Mother's back. She needs some help." Satsuki and May slipped into the wooden
wood garden sandals, which were much too big for them, and went through the garden to Mrs. Terashima's cottage. The room where they used to live on the second floor had been taken over by Uncle Terashima and Aunt Kyoko. This wasn't Satsuki and May's house anymore. Of course, that could be help. Still, every day was like a birthday. Satsuki explored the books in the bookstore. May's grandmother took her to the neighborhood sweet shop. One day, Aunt Kyoko took them to see a movie, and once Uncle took them to the amusement park. Today was another special day. Dinner was sukiyaki, to be cooked at the dinner table on a portable gas burner, which, by the way, sukiyaki is the name of one of my favorite songs. It kind of goes something like this. It's all because of you. I'm feeling sad and blue. You went away and my love's just a rainy day. I love you so. How much you'll never know. You took your love away from me. Oh, baby, you took your love away from me. And also, fun fact, kids, suki, S-U-K-I, is the Japanese word to say like, or I like suki, or daisuki. Daisuki, which means I love you, or love. But there's all so many different ways we can express liking someone or loving someone. Always food for thought. The more you know. Everyone was excited. Yone and Fumi hurried back and forth down the long corridor between the living room and the kitchen, carrying big plates heaped with the helpings and makings of sukiyaki. Thin sliced beef, mushrooms, vegetables, and tofu. Patient, Miss Satsuki. Dinner will be here soon, good-natured Fumi said as she hurried back to the kitchen for more. How could there be more? Satsuki wondered. Maybe Fumi was going to bring the rice. Satsuki sat on the tatami, waiting for the rest of the household. She wished she could help in the kitchen, but the one time she had offered, Yone told her, "You just be in the way!" Yone and Fumi handled all the housework. There was nothing for anyone else to do. Satsuki had finished her summer homework. Ooh, I do not miss that. I feel for the kids that are still in high school, middle school, elementary school that still have, like, summer work or... Actually, summer reading projects were great, especially if it was a book that I really, really liked. But, I don't know, just some of that stuff was really tedious, especially if it was math work. Ugh. Comment below if you do not like math or had trouble with math. To pass the time, she took a match from the box on the table, turned the valve on the gas burner, and lit the flame. The gas caught with a whoosh, and a circle of pretty blue-white flame appeared. This is so easy, she thought. Just strike the match. She was thinking about the kitchen and the haunted house. With this gas burner, you could have any size flame you wanted and no smoke. Satsuki, what on earth are you doing? Aunt Kyoko snatched the box of matches out of her hand. Startled, Satsuki jumped to her feet. Her aunt looked furious. You know better than to play with fire. You might influence the other children. You're in the fourth grade now. You're too old for such foolishness.
Play with fire?
Satsuki didn't know how to answer. All she could do was look away embarrassed. Unfortunately, this only made Aunt Kyoko angrier. Satsuki used matches morning and night in Matsugo. She worked hard to get the fire for the bath and for cooking just right. Cooking with fire was far harder than cooking with gas, but she knew how to use it to make miso soup, rice, and grilled fish. And every day she built a fire for the bath, coaxing the flames until the wood crackled and filled the room with its sweet aroma. But there was no way her aunt would listen to anything she had to say. Aunt Kyoko lowered her voice. Satsuki, I'm concerned. What's happened to you and May since you moved to Matsugo? I'm very disappointed in you. You walked around the house without your slippers. Your speech is careless. I think your mother would have been heartbroken if she could see how you're behaving. May's just as bad. Uncle was devastated when he saw what she did to his bonsai. She climbs trees, she walks into the pond and chases the fish, she crawled under the hedge into the next yard. Yuriko would never do anything like that. What makes you different? I don't know what's going on, but please don't play with fire again in this house. She stalked out of the room. Don't talk back.
That's what Yasuko had said the day they left for Tokyo.
Well, Satsuki thought, I couldn't talk back if I tried. How could she begin to explain her point of view or maze? In Matsuko, the kids crawled under and over whatever they liked, and no one said anything.
Satsuki knew that she never made Aunt Kyoko understand that. She'd just say,
what's wrong is wrong. Just because you don't get in trouble doesn't make it all right. What could Satsuki say?
No matter what, Aunt Kyoko always won. I have an aunt that's like that.
Satsuki was starting to wish she could go home. She wondered how Totoro's trees were doing. Maybe she'd come home to find a forest in the backyard. Her thoughts wandered from Totoro's trees to Uncle's prized bonsai. The memory made her wince. May had yanked the little pine tree out of its pot and clumsily tried to replant it in the backyard. When Aunt and Uncle confronted her, she told them angrily that trees were supposed to grow on the ground, not in little pots. When they didn't understand, she threw herself on the floor and cried her eyes out. It had been terribly embarrassing. Mrs. Terashima tried to best her calm May down, but this time at least May didn't deserve anyone's sympathy. Still, Satsuki had to admit that every day of their visit had been fun.
Life was convenient, clean, and easy. Easy was good. It was very good.
Beautiful starched sheets, light summer comforters with sparkling white covers, rice with every meal without lifting a finger. Life in Matsuko was very inconvenient. Or should I say independent?
I wonder what Kanta's up to.
For some reason, she suddenly thought of Kanta. She wondered what he would say if she told him what Aunt Kyoko had said about playing with fire. She'd probably just roll his eyes as if he had no idea what she was talking about.
No idea.
The haunted house had been empty for a week. Kanta was feeling a bit lonely. So far, he'd been spent most of his vacation loafing and avoiding his chores. Every day, from morning to dusk, he roamed all over Matsuko with his friends. Kanta's vacations were packed with activity. He begrudged the day the sun was going down for the day. If it were daylight all the time, he thought grumpily, he would have had that many more hours in the day to play. Today had been for a swim in the river. Tomorrow he was going to the hills behind his house to set bird traps. Next day he'd be up on Mount Hake. The day after that was Sukumori Woods, and after that fishing in the pond. He was a busy guy. He didn't have time to warm a chair or waste time on summer activities, but now assignments, but now and then things would get a little slow. It was 2 o'clock. The sun beat down. Everything was quiet. The village and its people, the cows and the horses, were taking refuge from the heat. Kanta was sprawled on the floor reading a comic book when his six-year-old brother, Shigeta, wandered in. Shigeta had just completed his first half year of elementary school. Is Satsuki back? He said to his brother.
Kanta was startled.
What makes you think she's back? I heard people talking. Go out into the road and see if you can see anything, Kanta said.
An order was an order.
Shigeta ran outside and came back.
I didn't see anybody,
he said, but Kanta's curiosity was aroused.
He had to be sure.
Shigeta, go over to Satsuki's and see if she's back.
No way!
This was reasonable.
Shigeta had to stand up for himself occasionally.
You said she was back. She better be back,
Kanta grumbled, and got up from the floor. He went to the entryway and picked up his cicada pole. Shigeta watched him anxiously.
Where are you going?
Sukumori, Kanta said casually. For cicadas?
Yep.
Wait, I'm coming too. As they walked up the road towards the woods, Shigeta said,
so what about Satsuki's house?
After we catch some cicadas, Kanta said.
Soon they could see the Sukumori laurel. Let's walk in the creek, Kanta said. It's nice and cool.
Walking in the creek would also wash off some dirt and dust, make them more presentable. Excuse me. Throat went a little dry. Hi, Terry!
You better be nice to Rockstar Terry. You better be nice to him. Rockstar is Terry's lovable cat. Love you, Terry. Kanta remembered how Satsuki had been dressed when she left for Tokyo. He was beginning to think it might pay to take better care of his appearance. It felt good walking in the creek. Kanta was in a good mood. Nonchalantly, he scanned the haunted house for signs of life. Until Satsuki arrived, the house had been Kanta's stopping grounds. Because his grandmother was looking after the property, it was natural for him to be there. In any case, an empty house and yard was always a magnet for children. Kanta and his friends played Tarzan and pretended the cranberry thicket and its tunnels were a secret base, and he and his friends were in and out of the yard all the time. That's my best Tarzan impression, by the way. Don't at me, okay? Once the high-class Kusakabe family moved in, the haunted house became something of a mystery for Kanta and the other children. Maybe this would be a good time to see if anything had changed. Let's check it out, Kanta said. With Shigata, bringing up the rear, Kanta crossed the footbridge and walked up the path to the yard. The cicadas in the branches above the path were shrieking so loud it almost hurt. As soon as it reached the top of the path, Kanta knew the house was still empty. The grass had grown taller and thicker since he trimmed it for Granny. The vines and creepers had spread rapidly. No one seemed to be caring for the garden. Insects cawed raucously from the grass. The shuttered house and its yard really did look haunted. Satsuki's wavy hair looked nice when the wind blew, Kanta thought. The house with its western-style design was the perfect backdrop for Satsuki and her smart clothes, and her little sister with the foreign-sounding name. That is, if only they were there.
Kanta, look at this!
Shigata waved to him from over by the pine tree.
I found something funny!
Kanta ran to see what his brother was looking at. It was a little sign on a stick, stuck on the ground next to a plot like a flower bed with rocks around the edge. Kanta read the sign aloud. This will be a forest someday. Please wait. What's that supposed to mean? The plot was full of weeds. Kanta pushed them aside, wondering if anything else was growing there. Down among the weeds, he found little seedlings coming up from the soil. These are trees, he thought. He scratched his head and read the sign again. Satsuki's handwriting was nice. He could almost hear her voice. They're doing this wrong, he said. He pushed the weeds aside and found more seedlings. Oak and yew, black pine and cedar, zelkova and walnut. Where did they get the seeds from? He shook his head and began skillfully clearing the weeds from around the little trees. Shigata, go find a bucket and bring me some water. They need better drainage. Let's dig a trough around them. Kanta thought, if I do that much, Satsuki and May just have to come back. And that is where we will end for tonight. Ba-da-ba-ba. Also, this chapter didn't have an illustration, which is rather interesting. But I hope you enjoyed this reading. Like I said, you don't have to watch these when they go live. Please, please subscribe to the YouTube channel. It definitely helps me out to be able to, hopefully one day soon, be able to go live on YouTube. Which, by the way, it's the 1st of March. This is the month where Storytime with Chris first premiered, which I believe, if I'm not mistaken, March 27th is the actual day Storytime with Chris started. So I'm super excited. It's 2 years, y'all. I got to see 2 years of this wonderful love and passion project that I wanted to do, not for fame, not for notoriety, just to bring the magic of literature and reading to you all. See you later, y'all. Thanks so much.